Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Center for International Governance Innovation, or CIGI as we say. My name is Fred Kuntz, and I'm the Vice President of Public Affairs here at CIGI. Thank you all for joining us here at the CIGI Auditorium for this evening's lecture. Thanks also to our public event sponsor, Wordsworth Books, for their ongoing support of the Signature Lecture Series. And thank you to tonight's co-sponsor of this event, the Balsillie School of International Affairs. We also thank those who are joining us through our live webcast. Following this evening's address, we welcome questions from both audiences at the microphones here at CIGI, or if you're watching at home through the live chat function on your screen. Please remember to state your name and to keep the questions brief. Environmental patterns act as a window into the state of our planet. The increasing reality of environmental disasters and extreme weather events gives us a clear view of a planet approaching some sort of breaking point. While it's our actions in the past that have pushed our world to this point, it's our actions in the future that must provide the solution. Tonight, Johan Rockström, Executive Director of the Stockholm Resilience Center, will share his latest research on the sustainability of our planet and the shift that's necessary for environmental recovery. Here to introduce tonight's speaker more properly is Simon Dalby. Simon is CIGI Chair in the Political Economy of Climate Change at the Balsillie School and Professor of Geography and Environmental Studies at Wilfrid Laurier University. He's also co-organizer with the University of Waterloo of a workshop on climate change this week at the CIGI campus. I see many of the attendees are here. And that event is one of the chief reasons for Professor Rockström's visit to Waterloo. Please join me now in welcoming Simon to the stage.
Thank you. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Professor Johan Rockström to us all tonight. He's a very distinguished international scientist on global sustainability, currently the director of the Stockholm Resilience Center in Stockholm, and also, of course, a professor at Stockholm University, too. He's got a long and distinguished CV. I just want to touch a few of the highlights tonight, which seem to be particularly relevant to the topic he's going to address us on in a moment. He's a science advisor to the World Business Council on Sustainable Development. He's been involved with giving scientific advice to the United Nations and to Ban Ki-moon's Sustainable Development Goal process. He's been co-chair with Professor Jeffrey Sachs of the Earth Institute, working on a project called the Sustainable Development Solutions Network, dealing with planetary boundaries and related issues. He's involved with the Swedish government's Future Commission and has been elected Sweden's most influential person on environmental issues 2 years in a row. In 2009, Focus magazine voted him Swede of the Year. He's probably best known to audiences in North America for being the lead author of a paper that appeared in Nature in 2009 called A Safe Operating Space for Humanity. He's also one of the authors of the updated version, which appeared in Science Journal back in January. He's involved in a new research project with the Earth Institute and EASA, the Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, looking at the world in 2050, pathways towards a sustainable future. Some of those themes are in his latest book, which is called Big World and Small Planet, which is due for release in Canada in May. Unfortunately, we don't have advanced copies here tonight, but it's coming soon. And it's on that topic of Big World and Small Planet that he's going to talk to us tonight. Please join me in welcoming Johan Rockström.
Thanks, Simon. Thanks, Fred. It's a great privilege to be speaking here at CGI and the Balsillie School, and particularly given that I've received so much inspiration in this work, not least from Jim Balsillie himself, last time passing through the Northwest Passage and hearing all the stories about finding the Erebus. And so it's fantastic to be here at the heart of this very innovative and cutting-edge school and institute. What I'll be doing now, over the next 50 minutes, is a scientific update of the rising evidence of an unprecedented global risk facing humanity. But I promise you that I'll be putting forward also equal amount of evidence of how that can be transformed into an opportunity for a transition towards a new future, a positive future of abundance and prosperity within a safe operating space of a stable and resilient planet. So it will start with the risk analysis and then transition over to how this translates to the big challenge and opportunity for humanity. For my students, I normally always start here to explain that I think that this is the most important scientific message to humanity, the empirical evidence that we've now become our own geological epoch. It was first suggested by Nobel Prize laureate Paul Crutzen in 2002 that we can now see so large pressures by humanity on planet Earth that we, Anthros, 7.2 billion people multiplied by the industrial metabolism we represent, have become the largest single force of change at the planetary scale. We're now welcome to the Anthropocene. I normally say to my students that that means, whether we like it or not, that we need to relate to a 369 world. In fact, I had to adjust this quite recently because, in fact, it shows today that it's rather a 4610 world, that we, on average, are following a pathway that would take us to 4 degrees Celsius warming by end of this century, a place we haven't been to for the past 4 or 5 million years. We are in the midst of the 6th mass extinction of species, the first caused by another species, and we are on average following a route towards 10 billion co-citizens on Earth, all with the right to development. So it's this 4610 world that's the reality of the Anthropocene that we need to relate to. The Anthropocene is a debated issue. Is it really so that we need to scrap our thinking, what we learned in high school, that we're in the Holocene, and now change all these school books into now calling ourselves as being in the Anthropocene? In the latest issue of Nature, there's a whole update on the discussions from the Geological Society in the UK that is now discussing in a commission whether we should rebaptize our epoch. And I would argue that, yes, this will occur. There's enough evidence to support this to be an established fact. The big discussion is rather when it starts. Did it start 8,000 years ago with the invention of domestication of animals and plants, when we became farmers from being hunters and gatherers? Or is it, in fact, which I will argue in this talk, around 1955, when we kicked off in what has now been called clearly the great acceleration of the human enterprise? There is in this issue, by the way, a very important signature event, which may be the real moment of the start of the Anthropocene, which is with the first nuclear bomb test in 1944, which actually gives geologically a strata signature that can be measured even in 1,000 or 2,000 years' time. The key transition, though, is not in 1955. The key transition, I will argue, is in 1990. Because in 1990, there's rising evidence that this is the point when we move from a relatively small world on a large planet, a situation that, in fact, could host unsustainable economic growth because there was still enough space on planet Earth to buffer rising environmental unsustainable pressures. There was enough atmosphere for continued emission of greenhouse gases, enough fish stocks in the ocean, enough buffering capacity of nutrient pollution, enough forests left to be cut down for the resilience of the planet to largely maintain the negative feedbacks of dampening and lowering of disturbance to keep the planet reasonably able to deliver to the economy. But from the 1990s onwards, we actually shift over to be a relatively large world on a small planet, because this is the first evidence we see of the Earth system starting to send invoices back to the economy. We see the first sign actually not far from here, which is the collapse of cod fisheries outside of Newfoundland, a complete shock that it actually are thresholds and multiple stable state in stocks of different living beings. We see the first multiple scale tipping points in lake systems going from desirable, oxygen-rich, fish-rich systems into agnoxic, murky, dead lake systems. We see the Baltic Sea flipping in 1989. We see the first cases of transgressing a boundary for greenhouse gas emissions, showing a large-scale accelerated melting of ice in the Arctic. We see for the first time that it seems that our punches on the Earth system over the 50 years of great acceleration starts to saturate. In the words of Will Steffen, one of the leading scientists behind the evidence that we've entered the Anthropocene, we seem to now be hitting the ceiling of hardwired biophysical processes at the Earth system. Or to quote John Schellenhuber, the head of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research, we seem to have reached a saturation point. We've filled up the biosphere, we've filled up the atmosphere, we've filled up the cryosphere with so much pressure that now we need to simply transition into a new logic. And that logic, that scientific evidence, it's what took us to the analysis of planetary boundaries, which is summarized in the book, which unfortunately is not out yet in North America, but which was pre-launched at the World Economic Forum as a way of influencing and sharing with world leaders the latest recognition that we are in the Anthropocene and now need to start transitioning into a new logic, which again is not a logic of saying we've gone too far, let's back off. It's a logic of saying let's now have abundance, innovation, and transition within a safe operating space. What may surprise you is that the key message in this book is not a certain blueprint for an operational strategy, is not a key invention that would solve all issues. It's really about a mind shift. It's about reconnecting societies to the biosphere, about a new relationship between humanity and planet Earth. And it may surprise you even more to say that the key message, I would argue, in this book is that if we can preserve the remaining beauty on Earth, we have a very good chance of successfully enabling prosperity for humanity. Because in every culture, across every nation in the world, there is a bounded universal relationship between human culture and nature, and we can all define what we mean by beauty, and often that beauty is, in fact, the redundancy and diversity of species in our landscapes and seascapes, the quality of air, the availability of high-quality fresh water, that much of what we value emotionally, in fact, translates to the rational natural science assessment of what builds a stable and resilient planet. Now, to summarize then the story, we are in a new global context. We can welcome humanity to the Anthropocene. We need to now recognize the rising risk of potentially catastrophic tipping points, which I'll be going through. I'll be explaining why the situation is so dramatic, because we can increasingly show empirically that the Holocene, the last 10,000 years of extraordinary stable conditions on Earth, is our desired planetary state. And if you know these three things, we've become our new geological epoch, tipping points cannot be excluded, we need to safeguard the Holocene. That is what translates to a new analysis, an analysis that shows that we need a great transformation into a safe operating space, and that this can be done by thinking in terms of abundance and prosperity. So that's the story, and off we go. The question is this understood outside of science, though, before we go into the diagnostic? And I would say the answer is yes. Something is happening in the world. You may have seen this messy diagram. It's the famous World Economic Forum Global Risk Report that comes out each year. It's actually an interview of 2,000 of the world's leading CEOs asking the question, what is it that makes you most nervous in terms of risks for your business? And not surprisingly, you see the kind of the obvious ones of regulatory failures, corruption, governance failures, economic collapse, all the issues that we discuss and see so much in media. But what might be more surprising is that these CEOs are deeply concerned of how that connects to the life support systems on Earth. Here you see air pollution, climate change, food security, biodiversity loss, flooding, infectious diseases, the recognition that we now live in a coupled system where business also must relate to the underlying risks of deteriorating a stable planet. You may have seen this large article in Financial Times that referred to the first scientific analysis of so-called infinite or existential risks, the realization that we've come to a point where we can no longer exclude eradicating civilization as we know it. These are 12 risks scientifically supported that actually could eradicate 2+ billion people on Earth, of which global governance collapse and system collapses in societies are a few of them, but here you also have ecological collapse, climate change collapse, large pandemics as an integral part of that analysis. In fact, one of the authors of this work from the Future of Humanities Institute at the Martin School of Oxford University was asked in this Financial Times article, well, what happens if we add up all these global existential risks? What's the probability that we would eradicate civilizations on Earth before year 2100? And he said, well, we don't have that number, but everything under 5% would be an over-optimistic assessment. So this is just a proof that we are in a new situation where we as humans are in fact a large world on a relatively small planet. Well, Tad Homer-Dixon from the school here has written a lot about how that crisis can actually translate to positive transformation in his famous The Upside of Down, and that will be a red thread here, that the inside of risk is not a doomsday analysis, it's actually the source of opportunity for transformation. In fact, at this point of a lecture with Paul Burke, the CEO of Nestle, he interrupted me and said, you know, Johan, I don't mind that you lay out all the risk cards on the table, because my definition of a pessimist is a well-informed optimist. And that is in itself, I think, one of those insightful values of having all the cards on the table. What do these cards tell us? Well, they tell us some new stories. This is what I think is one of the new stories of the Anthropocene, the rising evidence that even such a calamitous social catastrophe as the war in Syria can no longer be decoupled from the Anthropocene and global environmental change. In fact, two independent scientific papers published just over the last 2-3 months show that the 4 years before the war broke out in Syria were the worst droughts on record, probably since the Mesopotamian agricultural revolution 8,000 years ago. And that during these 4 years of consecutive unprecedented droughts, which cannot be disconnected from human-induced climate change, over 2 million people were forced out of farming communities and flowed into the big cities of Aleppo and Damascus, triggering even Assad to write memos of nervousness of the social turbulence that this could create. And then right after this drought, we have the social disruption that triggered the war. Now, these are, of course, very difficult causalities. You could even call this putative scientific evidence. But we have exactly the same story for the Arab Spring. The Arab Spring, which is clearly a social disruption from a generation of young, well-connected people who rose against decades of dictatorial rule, triggered by the self-immolation of a vegetable salesman in Tunis. But we also know that phosphorus prices rose by 350% the years before. We know that Prime Minister Rudd in Australia and President Putin in Russia shut export borders for food because of unprecedented forest fires in Russia and 12 years of drought in Australia, triggered and not possible to decouple from human-induced climate change. And that led to volatility in food prices in the world, which in turn resulted in food riots in the big capital cities from Tunis to Cairo just before the Arab Spring. Again, very difficult to set the fingers of causality, but I would argue that this may be the first example ever in human existence on Earth of a social ecological collision causing a whole nation state to destabilize. So this is the reality of the Anthropocene. So what's then the evidence that we can talk of ourselves have come to this point? Well, it comes from this kind of data. This is the observational data recently updated just in January 25, 2015, of the exponential rise in pressures since the Industrial Revolution. And I'll just walk these through very rapidly. So, and I'll go over this. This is actually showing an equivalent kind of exponential rise, but related to antibiotic resistance and disease frequencies. But here you have the patterns. So you see an x-axis from 1750 until today, so from the Industrial Revolution until today. And what you see is very limited pressures from humanity up until the mid-1950s, and then off we go in the great acceleration. And here you have some of the pressure points with primary energy use, world population growth, urban population, GDP growth, of course, direct investments, large dam constructions, freshwater use, paper production, fertilizer consumption, transportation, telecommunications rising, tourism, all of them leading to response and impacts on the Earth system, which looks exactly the same. So you can actually pick essentially any parameter that matters for our human well-being and which determines our economic development. They look as follows. You've all seen this hockey stick, which is the carbon dioxide exponential rise since the mid-1950s. But so it goes also for methane release, nitrous oxide related to particularly transport systems and industry, temperature rise, depletion of a stratospheric ozone layer, which you see is leveling off from the 1990s, and I'll come back to that, thanks to an agreement here in Canada from Montreal. Fish capture, ocean acidification related to climate change, eutrophication of coastal regions due to modern agriculture, shrimp agriculture production, deforestation, land use expansion, and here, in my mind, the most dramatic one, the exponential rise and loss of species on Earth. So you add all these hockey sticks up, and they look like this, and they look uniformly like this, that up until the mid-1950s, we did have environmental problems, but they were largely local, and we did not add up to being a force of change at the planetary scale. But in 1955, 10 years after the Second World War, we're 3.5 billion people. This is when we put in the high gear of industrial metabolism, going to scale, and off we go in the exponential rise, which takes us to the top of these curves. Now, the warnings came early, but they were shot down. You may recall that Rachel Carson wrote her seminal Silent Spring in 1962, warning us for the effects of a chemical industrial society killing off bird species and other species, causing silence in our natural habitats. The Limits to Growth report of Club of Rome came out in 1972, warning that by 2020, under business as usual, we could see a drawdown of world economic growth. These were shot down by conventional economists and policymakers, but you could actually, when looking at the curve, potentially excuse them. Because in fact, Rachel Carson and the Club of Rome had very little empirical evidence to base their early warnings from. In fact, you could argue that they were insightful personalities warning humanity way before the fact. Today, we're up here. We're in fact the first generation to know that there's no excuse for inaction, because we're sitting at the top of multiple hockey sticks proving increased pressures on the Earth system. So that's the difference today. And I emphasize this because we environmental scientists tend to often get as a reaction, well, you've been warning us for 50 years and nothing seems to happen, and now you're warning us even more. Well, in fact, that's not true, because this synthesis of these hockey sticks I just show you came out the first time in 2007 and the update in 2015. And in fact, the early warnings in the mid-1950s and 60s were actually based on very little empirical evidence. Now we have that empirical evidence in our hand. And what are the risks that this pressure translates to? Because the hockey sticks only gives us answer to one thing. We're clearly punching the system. Now the question is, how does Mother Earth respond to those punches? Well, she's not responding linearly. That's the conclusion from science. And there is a humbleness here, which is related to the fact that we are shifting ourselves outside of a desired state with so many magnitudes. And this is one example of how to illustrate that. This is 2,000 years of ice core data, the classic ice core data that you've certainly seen. On the y-axis, you have variation in temperature. It's only from 0 to 2 degrees Celsius on the band of variation. So an extraordinarily stable global mean temperature over the past 2,000 years. And then off we go, and you see the early warming, which has taken us to 0.8 degrees Celsius warming just over the past 50 years. And this is the path we're following. In fact, we're heading towards a point which is so many magnitudes outside of the extreme variability of the past 2,000 years that we can really talk of us pushing the entire planetary system away from what we know is normal. Science has had difficulty in assessing these risks, admittedly. But I'll just show you one thing which is, I think, also humbling in this, in terms of what happens when we scientists learn more and more of how the Earth system responds. Well, I can tell you there's only one red thread, which is the more we learn, the more nervous there is reason to be. Now, this graph looks very complicated, but it's actually essential, and it shows a trend line in terms of risk analysis. It is three consecutive IPCC reports, the United Nations Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report, the third assessment from 2001, the fourth assessment from 2007, and the latest one now from 2013. So it's the progression of knowledge over the past 10 years. Now I want you to look just at these columns at the bottom of each assessment, which shows the risk of human-induced large-scale discontinuities. To put it in simple language, human-induced disaster. And what you have on the y-axis, on the x-axis here, is at what temperature does science assess that we could cause large-scale catastrophes, meaning that we would irreversibly start melting the Greenland ice sheet, that we would irreversibly collapse the world's coral reef systems, that we would irreversibly push
the rainforest across a tipping point, causing them to collapse.
Well, if you look carefully, you'll see that in 2001, the assessment was that that could not occur until we reached 4 or 5 degrees warming. We learned more and more, and in 2007, the assessment was between 3 and 5. And today, the risk of large-scale discontinuities has eaten itself down to 2.5 degrees and upwards. So the more we understand of the self-regulating complex Earth system, the more we understand of surprise and nonlinear dynamics, the more we realize that the Earth system can, earlier than we previously thought, respond in ways that would push ourselves irreversibly in the wrong direction. So not only do we have the evidence of the hockey sticks, we also have the evidence that nonlinear dynamics or large-scale tipping points are an integral part of the way the Earth system operates. Now, how does this translate in terms of business language of risk? Well, there's been a foundation called the Global Challenges Foundation that translates the latest IPCC in terms of risk language. And this is a really important insight for the following reason. You may be aware that the IPCC is the consensus among 3,000 plus scientists. So I will argue very strongly that it's a conservative analysis. In fact, there's a lot of science to suggest that the IPCC underestimates risks. For example, the climate models do not include risks of large-scale catastrophic tipping points in their scenario analysis. But let's take the IPCC as a reference point and ask ourselves the following question. What is the risk of us reaching an incredibly high warming of 6 degrees Celsius? Now, I choose 6 degrees Celsius for two reasons. One is that 6 degrees Celsius is clearly a totally catastrophic outcome. In fact, there's no evidence at all that we can support anything that we consider to be a modern world in a world of 6 degrees. But the second reason to take 6 degrees is that I would even argue that probably every climate skeptic, even a climate denialist, would agree that that's not a good place. So it's a pedagogic temperature. Okay? Now, what's the probability at our current concentration of greenhouse gases of today, 25th of March 2015, where we are at roughly 450 ppm for all greenhouse gases, 400 for CO2. Well, the probability of a, for everyone, undesired outcome at current concentration of greenhouse gases, according to a conservative assessment, the IPCC, is 1.6%. Well, what is 1.6%? Well, if you talk to Munich Re and Swiss Re, the big reinsurance companies that reinsure insurance companies against catastrophic risk, they say, we don't sell premium insurance premiums for risks of catastrophic outcomes that go above a few promille. We don't operate at percentage levels because that would be too expensive. We cannot afford those kind of risk levels. In fact, 1.6%, believe it or not, is the equivalent of us accepting 1,500 fatal aircraft accidents every day. Every day. So it just proves that for climate, we are accepting a risk level already today in 2015 that way exceeds any risk level that we would ever accept for a catastrophic outcome in any other parts of society, be it insurance for car accidents or housing or for fatal aircraft accidents. So this is quite surprising that when it comes to our own life support systems, we are operating clearly under some different logic than normal risk analysis. What is it that takes us to these risk levels? Well, it is about tipping points, and it's about understanding the fundamental regulators of the stability of the Earth system. And this is one of them. This is how we want the polar regions to be, or northern Canada for that matter, a permanent white surface. This permanent white surface is a reflector. It's actually a cooling system. The Arctic and Antarctica are permanent cooling systems because they reflect back 80-90% of incoming heat back to space. Now we're seeing in the northern parts of Arctic, and in fact, Jim, this photo is taken during our joint journey, of an accelerated melting of sea ice in the Arctic. We're seeing rapid melt of ice in Greenland, which of course has massive effects on local communities and biodiversity, but it particularly changes color, which changes the albedo and reflectivity, potentially risking to make the large polar regions from being coolers to being heaters, a shift in feedback, a tipping point. Now, I think this is the most important graph out there from science because this is showing the first signs of something like that potentially happening.
This is satellite data from NASA over Greenland. It shows on the y-axis the albedo, the reflectivity, and in colored lines over months of the year, from January to December, you see the desired state of a Holocene stable planet, meaning that roughly 90% of incoming heat is reflected back to space in winter. It goes back down slightly during summer because naturally Greenland is melting in the fringes, meaning that you have a liquid surface which is slightly darker. And then something happens in 2012, which is the black line. So 3 years ago, something extraordinary occurs, to everyone's surprise. For 2 weeks, the entire Greenland ice sheet is a liquid surface. The entire Greenland ice sheet is melting in an extraordinarily warm period. And suddenly the reflectivity goes through the floor, and calculations by Jason Box and colleagues at the Byard Institute indicates that during those 2 weeks, the new injection of heat, because Greenland goes from a net cooler to net warming, is something in the order of 100 exajoules of energy. And this trend line has been going on since the year 2000. So if you accumulate that whole 12-year period, the injection of heat corresponds to roughly 300 exajoules of new heat into the atmosphere. Now, that's a big number. So just to give you a reference of what it means, the global energy consumption each year is 600 exajoules, twice that amount. The US uses every year roughly 200 exajoules of energy. So it means that Denmark momentarily bypasses China and the US as the world's largest climate-forcing nation on Earth. Not because the Danes emit so much carbon dioxide, but because Greenland shifts her feedback. So this is just to give you an example of exactly what requires a new thinking in terms of how we relate to planet Earth. This is data coming out just a few weeks ago, showing that 2014 is the warmest year ever on record. On red here, you see places that have the warmest ever recorded mean temperature for 2014. But you see some blue spots here, which is very likely related to in the north, and you felt it here in Canada, the risk that you get Arctic jet stream behavior moving down, that essentially northern hemisphere regions get Arctic climate and you get an exceptional warming in the Arctic. But look at that little blue spot here, which is a very surprising one, and it's systemic and generic, that there seems to be something occurring in the North Atlantic which is cooling. And this is the Gulf Stream that actually keeps my part of the world habitable at all. And there seems to be a slowdown of this system. Oops, there I did something wrong. Which actually was confirmed in a paper just last week by Stefan Ramstorff and colleagues, showing rightly that there is a temperature decline occurring in the Atlantic Ocean overturn, which probably is a first sign of a slowdown of the Gulf Stream. So we're seeing big, big shifts occurring related to climate change. Now, if we go to Antarctica, the big resilience question has always been, well, if the Arctic is the vulnerable little sister, which is clearly moving in a rapid negative direction, at least we can rely on a stable Antarctic system, which even has had some evidence of growth in ice. Unfortunately, two independent research teams, surprising again in May 2014, published this analysis showing that even in the West Antarctic ice shelf, we're starting to see glaciers moving irreversibly down into the ocean because of warming and lubrication from a warm ocean from below. Now, the drama here is the following. The Thwaites Glacier, which is now moving irreversibly into the ocean, is an ice plug holding the upstream, a whole series of upstream glaciers in place. So the conclusion from these analyses is that this is a tipping point, that these glaciers will now irreversibly reach the ocean, adding another 1 meter of average sea level rise risk this century to the 1 meter that the IPCC already conservatively has assessed. And 1+1, I would argue, takes us probably beyond adaptation over this century. So again, an example of why we need to relate and understand nonlinear dynamics. It's same for methane release in the East Siberian Arctic shelf, risks of accelerated release, which in this commentary is actually translated to money. It could cost the world economy $70 trillion of allowing this large release to occur. And we're seeing biospheric systems tipping over quickly from desired coral reef states into undesired states related to both overfishing, nutrient pollution, and climate change, which actually undermines the economy for hundreds of millions of people depending on these systems in coastal regions. And you see more and more synthesis of this kind showing quite precisely where are the systems that could tip over quite abruptly. This is the famous T Tim Lenton, John Schellenhuber tipping element map, showing the systems that have this nonlinear behavior. So overall, and I promise you from now on I won't say anything negative anymore, this is the stop point for the diagnostic, but it is, again, all the cards on the table, that if you summarize all of this in just one statement, it is now we have two giants colliding. The first giant is what I've gone through, which is the recognition that in the Anthropocene, with the pressures we're putting on the Earth system, the response is unlikely to be incremental, linear, and therefore predictable. The response seems to be much more likely invoices coming as surprise and turbulence, and that these could unfortunately trigger irreversible changes. The second giant is the fact that we are 7.2 billion, we're committed to 9 by 2050, most likely potentially 10 billion given the dynamics in Africa, everyone with a right to development, and we have, for the first time in modern history, the opportunity to eradicate poverty. So nations in the world in September will be agreeing over the Sustainable Development Goals framework to eradicate poverty by 2030 because we're seeing the opportunity to do so. So we're coming to a situation where we'll have 4, 5, 6 billion, not 1.5 billion as today, middle-class citizens with a purchasing power and aspirations of lifestyle equivalent to most of us in this room. That's the collision. The collision of affluence going to scale with nonlinear dynamics and catastrophic tipping points not being excluded. And this collision happens now. It's not something that happened 50 years ago. So we've been on this exponential rise journey in a situation where the Earth system has been resilient. She's been standing and taking punch after punch after punch. And moreover, it's been a minority in the world that has been the largest cause for this, the rich minority. But now the minority is becoming a majority, and we are in a saturation point. Believe me, to me, that's evidence enough that a transformation is needed, and is needed urgently. So how can that look like? How can we start that diagnostic? So a planetary boundary framework has the purpose of guiding that transition. So let's then go to how we came up with this framework. Well, the first thing that we then have to start with is actually, well, what is then our desired state of the planet? Can we define a desired state? And I will argue, yes. And again, the answer comes from IRIS Core data. This is a very interesting series. It's from Greenland, and it's picking out from the 1 million year that we normally look at, the last 100,000 years. It's a very interesting period because we've been modern humans on Earth for 160,000 years. So we've had the same, during this entire period, ability both physically and mentally to develop civilizations as we know it. On the y-axis, you have temperature variability, a good proxy of how it was to live on Earth. And as you see immediately, this was a jumpy ride for humanity indeed. In fact, we were few people on Earth, a few million. We were hunters and gatherers, and we had a really rough time. In fact, the latest data on this cold point here, where sea levels were 70 meters lower than today and fresh water was frozen in the poles, the most recent data indicates we were down to less than 15,000 fertile adults on Earth. You know, we were virtually extinct. We were hiding in the Ethiopian highlands, the last place where there was some biomass and fresh water and temperatures to allow us to survive. And that was a point where we were virtually gone. I mean, basically confirming that we're all very close relatives in this room, moreover. We jump around in this very jumpy period until we exit the last ice age and enter what we've started to call the Eden's Garden for human development, what we learned in school to call the Holocene, the last 10,000 years of extraordinary stable conditions on Earth. In fact, the maximum temperature variability is plus minus 1 degree Celsius. Now, the extraordinary thing with the Holocene is the following. The genetic diversity, which builds everything that contributes to the economy, has been around often for hundreds of millions of years. But it's in the Holocene that everything settles in that we depend on. So the rainforest, the savannas, the coral reefs, the beach forests, the temperate boreal forests that we depend on in the northern hemisphere, the hydrological cycle, the rainy seasons, the temperatures that allow us to grow food, everything settles in during the Holocene. In fact, the proof of this is so overwhelming because we barely enter the Holocene and we do the most important invention of all human history, namely we invent agriculture. And the interesting thing is we domesticate animals and plants in at least 4 different places on Earth simultaneously. And this is proof enough because it shows us something quite remarkable that, well, we know we had no smartphones and SMS and email possibility, so this was truly independent from each other. And most likely it means that we had the technology of domesticating, but the risks were too high outside of the Holocene. But when we year after year could see that rainy seasons and growing seasons came back predictably, we started to domesticate animals and plants, enabling us to start the differentiation towards innovation and societal development as we all know it. And we come to the point of the great acceleration. We're 7 billion today and committed to 9, 10 billion. So the conclusion from science is as simple as it is dramatic, that the Holocene is the only state of the planet that we know for certain can support the modern world as we know it. So if we take an ethical stance on a world with 9, 10 billion people, the Holocene is where we want to be. But we're in the Anthropocene, and therefore our big challenge is how can we transform ourselves back within a Holocene state. Now, that may sound and is dramatic, but it's so helpful because we know the Holocene. We know the carbon cycle, the nitrogen cycle, the halogical cycle, we know the biosphere composition, we know the stratosphere, we know the components of the oceans. So we can now ask ourselves the following question. What are the environmental processes that regulates the Holocene? And can we even ask and answer the second question? If we can identify these boundary processes or planetary processes, can we for each one of them even define, based on the best science we have, boundaries beyond which we risk inducing catastrophic tipping points? And if we can quantify those boundaries, can we therefore create a safe operating space within which we can thrive in the future? And there you have, in a nutshell, the planetary boundary framework, which has as its purpose to allow for a concept of prosperity within a safe operating space. Now, the first analysis, as was referred to earlier, came out in 2009. The update came out just a few months back in Science. And the remarkable thing that has happened is that when this paper came out in 2009, it triggered an enormous amount of scientific discussion, which was exactly what we aimed for. In fact, since the publication, there's been over 60 scientific peer-reviewed articles, even with planetary boundaries in the title. There's been over, you know, thousands of citations, an enormous amount of scientific discussion and improvements. So it's been an enormous privilege to then sit down and scan all this up and update it in 2015, because we didn't even know, had we got just the number of boundaries right, and for each one of them, had we got the quantifications right. And the reassuring thing is that the 9 planetary boundaries that we identified in 2009 have been reaffirmed in 2015. So it appears we got it right. And what are these boundaries then? Well, I won't go through them very much in detail, but just to rapidly kind of give the summary statement, that they include 3 that we all recognize, and there's ample scientific evidence that there are planetary scale tipping points regulating the stability of the planet. It's the climate system, it's the stratospheric ozone layer, and it is ocean acidification. Then more surprisingly, there are 4 boundaries which don't have evidence of planetary scale catastrophic tipping points. They're local tipping points, but they regulate the stability of the Earth system under the hood. They're slow variables that kind of tweak and twine and take disturbances and buffer and help us to stay in a stable state. And they include the land systems, they include freshwater use, they include biodiversity loss, and they include, finally, the way we interfere with the big nutrient cycles of nitrogen and phosphorus. And then finally, there are 2 boundaries which are perhaps less obvious because they're so intimately connected to human-created boundaries. The first one is chemical pollution, which is novel entities in the whole Earth system. And the second one is what we call aerosol loading, which is basically air pollution and the way we can create smog, which can affect the large rainfall systems, for example, on Earth. Quantifications of these are very difficult. We were able to suggest quantifications for 7 out of the 9, and it led already in 2009 to the conclusion that we are already in a danger zone for 3 of them: climate, biodiversity, and nitrogen. And the 2015 update, which is here in numbers, and I'll now go through this in detail, so I hope you can read the numbers here. No, joking, I will not do that. But just to give you some of the highlights, so this is from the Science paper. The climate change boundary has been even more robustly defined with an even more narrow uncertainty range. I think we are in a very good position scientifically to defend that boundary, which is now set at 350 ppm as a maximum boundary for carbon dioxide. We are at 400, as I mentioned earlier, for carbon dioxide, 450 for all greenhouse gases, so we are in a danger zone there. We've done a major update and improvement on the biodiversity boundary based on critique from very leading ecologists around the world who have rightly emphasized that it's not the number of species that is the most important, it's what role species play in regulating the stability of landscapes. So we've added the function of ecosystems besides extinction rates. We have totally improved the phosphorus and nitrogen boundary based on critique coming from the International Nitrogen Initiative scientists and also from a leading phosphorus scientist, Steve Carpenter, who enabled us to improve these numbers very significantly, which has now been done. Similarly, with land system change, we've now transformed it from the minimum amount of cropland or maximum amount of cropland to the minimum amount of forest systems we need to maintain on Earth, concluding that temperate, boreal, and rainforest are the three regulating systems that are, for example, massive carbon sinks and regulates the biological cycle. And finally, on freshwater use, we've done something very significant to take the global consumptive use of freshwater down to the river basin scale. So we can say for every river basin in the world, the minimum amount of freshwater we need to maintain to secure the resilience at the river basin scale. So this is just to give you a little quick update of the fact that the 2015 update stands robust on the massive advancements of scientific peer review that has gone on for the last 5 years. And it leads to this summary statement, which is that, in fact, we've most likely already entered a danger zone for four boundaries. So not only the nitrogen and phosphorus boundary, but also for land system change, deforestation, climate change, and biodiversity. So 4 out of 9 are in this danger zone, and you see the safe operating space, which is then being encroached increasingly through this analysis. Now, why are these 9 boundaries so important to keep in mind simultaneously? Can we not deal with one at a time? Well, in fact, we cannot. And this is the most pedagogic way of explaining that. This shows to the left the cumulative amount of greenhouse gases we've emitted since the Industrial Revolution. Actually, we've emitted an astonishing 545 billion tons of carbon. Now, that has led to 0.85 degrees Celsius warming so far. But is it the cumulative 545 that are all in the atmosphere? All these molecules are in the atmosphere? Well, no. As you're certainly aware, more than half are actually taken up by oceans and land-based ecosystems as what I would call the world's largest free subsidy to the world economy. And that this enormous and remarkable subsidy is part of resilience building because, astonishingly, over the past 50 years, this carbon sink has doubled in size, showing something which I've emphasized earlier, that the Earth system has been our best friend, showing remarkable proof of biophysical resilience by being disturbed, our emission greenhouse gases, and responding to that disturbance by increasing the carbon sink. Now, unfortunately, we see the first signs in the literature that these carbon sinks may be losing pace, for example, in the Amazon. But this is why we need to keep the land boundary, the biodiversity boundary, the water boundary, and the climate boundary intact in order to be able to have a safe future. The second thing that this analysis allows us to do is to understand time. So this is the pre-industrial situation. Actually, we are right in the middle of this safe operating space. We have not encroached at all on the safe operating space. So this is 1750. Now, in 1950, already then, modern agricultural development had expanded so much, we are in the red with regards to biodiversity loss. But you see that we are very, very safely in the space for the other boundaries. In fact, this is a period where conventional BNP-based, GDP-based economic growth works fine because the Earth system is subsidizing the economic growth. We are, so to say, polluting. We're not paying for it. But the Earth system is incredibly forgiving because we're in the safe operating space. In fact, it goes up until the 1970s without big problems. But look at what happens in 1990. We're jumping out dramatically on ozone depletion, and we are on the red with regards to phosphorus and nitrogen. What happens here? Well, policymakers and business listen to science, gathers in Montreal, signs the Montreal Protocol in 1987, forbidding the use of chlorofluorocarbons as cooling and heating agents, and we return back into the safe operating space for ozone in the current state. So we have an example of having, for one time, become planetary stewards of our planetary boundaries. And I try to emphasize this every time, because every time I put this graph on the wall, the answer I get, it's utopia. We can never become planetary stewards. How can we, as a world community, 200 countries, back off from this situation? Well, we've done it once. for ozone, and that would argue that we could potentially do it again. Now, my final 5 minutes is then, so what are the implications of all this diagnostic for how we govern our future? Well, to begin with, I think we have to redefine development. The best definition we have is this one. This is the famous Brundtland Commission definition of sustainable development in its 3 pillars. The pillar of social, natural, or environmental and economic development. I think we simply must conclude that this has not worked. It has actually turned into what we can call a Mickey Mouse economy, where the economy has grown at the expense of natural and human capital. We in fact need to transition into a new logic where the pillars are still there, but where the economy serves society, which operates within Earth's safe operating space. This is a fundamental shift, because what it implies is that we need to set science-based environmental goals at the planetary scale, which actually locks ourselves in absolute budgets within which we can prosper. So the climate boundary translates to a carbon budget. The carbon budget can be defined. Even the IPCC has defined it to 1,000 billion tons of remaining carbon dioxide to emit. In fact, divide that by 40, it gives us another 25 years in a fossil-fueled economy, by the way. And that budget needs to be shared in a fair way among all citizens on Earth. And this has been put forward to Ban Ki-moon, and I know that the Global Sustainability Panel that you served on, Jim, was really recognizing some of this thinking in its early work. And at least I think we can start to say that the Sustainable Development Goals Framework starts showing signs of understanding this. Because there you have social goals combined with global environmental goals, for example, for climate and fresh water. Is it possible then to transition back into a safe operating space? Well, there's a lot of evidence that that can be done. And there are 2 transitions which are more important than any other transition. The first one is to transition into a carbon-free or fossil fuel-free world energy system. And the second one is a transition to a sustainable food system in the future. If we get those 2 right, in fact, you tick off essentially all the boundaries back into safe operating space, because agriculture is the single largest cause behind biodiversity loss, land system change, deforestation, overuse of fresh water, and nutrient pollution. Now, the Global Energy Assessment showed a few years back that, yes, we can transition into a future where we stay within the boundary on climate change. And there's a lot of evidence to suggest that this is possible, and not least because of these curves. These are positive hockey sticks showing the remarkable exponential growth of solar and wind in a selected number of countries. In fact, you may be aware that if you wake up a morning, Saturday morning in Germany, the world's 4th largest economy, you're likely to get 25 to 50% of your electricity from solar and wind. So it is going to scale and has grid parity in many economies in the world. Jin, in a paper recently by John Foley and colleagues, we show that it is possible to feed humanity without encroaching on the land boundary, and that this is all about innovation and sustainable intensification. The World Business Council for Sustainable Development has taken the planetary boundary science and translated it into a so-called Action 2020 agenda, incorporating the boundary thinking right into business models. And Peter Bucker, the president of the World Business Council, officially today says CSR is dead. We need to integrate sustainability at the core of the business model. It cannot be something we do, you know, every so often in our sustainability report. In fact, it is something we deal with in the board room. In Japan, there's 1 solar rooftop every 2nd minute. The shutting down of nuclear power in Japan triggers an immense exponential rise in solar voltaics in Japan. And what's the avenue to trigger even more innovation on that energy transition? Well, one way would, of course, be to take away the $500 billion of subsidies that goes right into sustaining status quo and the risk of the subsidized fossil fuel energy systems. In fact, the Global Energy Assessment indicates or concludes that it would be enough with $1,500 billion in investment to start a global transition to renewable energy systems, 3 times this number, just showing that, you know, it's not unfeasible to think of a global transition to a sustainable energy future. So on all accounts, there's a lot of evidence that abundance and prosperity is possible through innovation and transformations if we lock ourselves within a safe operating space. So to conclude, what does this mean? Well, I would argue then, and that's what I tried to convey, that we still live in a world driven by a paradigm assuming that there are growth without limits. We can have infinite growth on a finite planet, and this has been pushing us towards these boundaries. We environmental scientists have probably, and I'm self-critical here, too strongly propagated limits to growth. Like Moses, we've been walking through the desert for 40 years, just creating even more lock-in and controversy between a growth paradigm and a limits paradigm. And that most likely science today is able to show a third pathway, a pathway of growth within limits or abundance within planetary boundaries. And are we seeing the signs of a social transition occurring? Are there social tipping points? I will argue that that is absolutely the case. We're starting to see something really exciting happening, a window opening up due to three big driving forces. The first one is remarkable. When 550,000 people walk through Manhattan in the People's Climate March, it is extraordinary for two reasons. One is that there were no barricades out that morning in Central Park because the police had expected 50,000 people. The second is that who was it in that march? Well, of course, you know, the extreme environmentalists were there, but all the entrepreneurs were there, the innovators were there, the young academic families with their teenagers were there. Ban Ki-moon was in the front. This was a social manifestation of an opportunity, not an environmental protection manifestation. The second driving force is this: climate change or anything that has to do with planetary boundaries is no longer an environmental issue. It is about development, it's about health. When Beijing and Paris gets classified as the world's most polluted and inhabitable cities because of unsustainable use of fossil fuels, it becomes a driver for something better. I talked just a few days ago with the CEO of Spotify, one of the largest and most rapid employers in Sweden. He says the reason why we can employ people to a capital like Sweden is that Stockholm is so livable as a capital. So livability is increasingly becoming a parameter that can be a key source to solutions. And finally, of course, innovation. If you go to the World Economic Forum and you walk through Davos, in the most prestigious high-level meeting in the world, every 10 meters, the best innovation of every company is displayed. Are these SUVs and Humvees? No, these are solar panels, Tesla cars. These is big panels showing that India now goes for 40 gigawatts of wind. The innovation, the cool stuff, is really in the renewable energy systems. I'm completely convinced that a young generation finds this future much more attractive than a future in a lock-in, in an unhealthy, undemocratic, increasingly volatile fossil future. So with these three driving forces, with the awareness growing, with the opportunity space, and the fact that this couples to other domains like health and development, I think is proof of a start of a very important tipping point. And the time is running out. Also for me, by the way. Thank you. So thanks for your patience. I've been asked now to kind of open the floor for anyone who's comment or question. It would be nice if it's not a long lecture, but rather kind of keep it relatively snappy. There are two microphones here. I think the easiest for me would be to kind of take answer and question straight off. And then there, I'll be trying also to keep an eye on the web here. There are questions coming in that way as well, so we can have that interaction. I think we have roughly half an hour to interact. And yes, please.
Hi, my name is Byron Williston. I'm a philosophy professor at Wilfrid Laurier. Great talk, thank you very much. I have a question about the concept of growth within limits. On its face, at least, perhaps you elaborate on this much more extensively in the book itself, but on its face, it looks like just an oxymoron. Because anything that continually grows must, logically must, burst through boundaries and limits. Do you mean that the economy, for example, can grow for a little while, or are we to believe the traditional economist's fantasy that it can grow forever, continually? Is that the claim, and that it can do so within limits?
Yeah, so let me first start by kind of a testimony.
In a way, that's always dangerous to do these days, because I know that everything is filmed and it stays on forever, and it kind of, you want sometimes to have a little cozy feeling of Chatham House, but in fact it isn't really, is it? but the testimony is that I would much, much more have preferred to use the term economic development rather than growth. But we've tended to actually speak out on growth because, you know, the majority in the world are aspiring for growth, and they are rightfully aspiring for growth. And in fact, we know that growth, even conventional growth, is a key for poverty alleviation. So that's just one caveat, that I think it's much more clever to talk of economic development than growth, to avoid ending up in exactly your question. But even if we stay with growth in its strict term, to me it is a question of how do we define growth. And if we do not define growth in its traditional just GDP form, but rather growth in terms of welfare and well-being and services, I certainly think that we can find the possibility of growing within a finite limit in many economies and in many sectors. I mean, one example which I think is the most convincing one is that we all know that if you plot GDP or economic growth and energy use, it's a linear relationship. And that's, of course, why the climate negotiations are so locked in, because developing countries say, you know, you're telling us that now the party is over, but we want growth, and we see from history that economic growth requires more modern energy use. But the beauty with the climate challenge, which means paradoxically it might be the easier of the nine boundaries to solve, is that there's perfect substitution between fossil fuel energy and renewable energy. We could think, I mean, at least theoretically, we could think of a conventional economic growth in the world powered by the sun, and you would actually decouple that boundary from economic growth. You would have risks of rebound effects, of course, with that growth, I agree. I think the place where I agree that you're most likely right is that in the end, thermodynamics apply, and it's impossible to keep systems in 100% closed loops. So both on resource use and pollution, in the end it's impossible or difficult to close the loops entirely. But I'm very enthusiastic over the ideas of circular economic business models, Ellen MacArthur's work and others showing that we can think of a world where we no longer sell stuff, but rather have relationship between companies and those providing computers or cell phones, meaning that you recirculate 100% of the goods and services, or the goods we buy, thanks to the fact that there's a different business model. I mean, the business model today is you extract, you consume, you construct, extract, produce, consume, and you waste. But if you can get that to be a closed loop system, you could actually think of growth within a finite space. And then finally, of course, growth has attributes which are not only material consumption. Growth can be other kinds of values that are generated in society. So I think there's a lot to say. I mean, my guess would be that perhaps two-thirds you could actually think of sustainable growth, but you have one-third which is, I think, admittedly very difficult on fresh water, biodiversity, certain extractive metals, where you simply gradually will end up hitting the ceiling, even if you do very well in terms of closing loops. But it's just to say that at least the early stage of this transition, I think we can foresee a continued growth without undermining our ability to actually also contribute to a transition. But the question needs to be probed, and it's, as you may know, a huge debate around green growth, sustainable growth. That's why I like economic development more. Shall I take one question here? How can local citizens turn crisis into opportunity within their own communities? Yeah, that's a very good question, and I'm actually very thankful for that question, because in the rush of a lecture like this, I'm sure you feel that I come across as a top-down type of person, thinking in terms of how we can be governed or clever stewards of planetary boundaries. But inspired very much by our close collaboration with the late Ellen Ostrom, the Nobel laureate Ellen Ostrom, who served on our board until she very tragically passed away. She was, you know, as you're all aware, certainly the big master of showing empirically that communities can do wonders through bottom-up collective action. That in fact we can, through trust building and knowledge and innovation, see communities taking grasp on sustainable transitions.
while even Lin admitted that in the Anthropocene, that will never be enough, that we need to combine spurring innovation from below with regulatory measures from above, that in fact we need global governance to work with local innovation. And I think this question pinpoints and reminds me of that opportunity of thinking of this not as either global or local, but rather thinking of ourselves as coupled across scales. And I think the way how one can turn crisis locally into an opportunity, to me, is a lot about putting pressure upwards in scale and expressing, like the People's Climate March, for example, the need for leadership from above, while at the same time, actions that show that this is an opportunity also locally. And of course, that is happening a lot with the transition towns and alternative cities and a whole bunch of wonderful initiatives where communities go together and show that on waste management, freshwater use, energy use, transport systems, we can quite rapidly transition. In fact, when it comes to energy use, most modern societies can, you know, very rapidly reduce energy use by 30% plus in our housing. Transport systems can be more collective and more effectively pursued. And on consumption, I mean, we can do magic very rapidly just by reducing meat consumption and being more smart in terms of consuming more plant-based diets. So I think that the local community action is absolutely critical, but cannot operate in isolation. Any more reflections or thoughts on this? Yes?
If you work with the WBCSD, how, on a scale of 1 to 10, say, how encouraged are you by what you see? Mm.
Yeah, so, well, that's another great question because, you know, WBCSD is a network of 200 companies that together represent 10% of the world economy. So they are a very important network, but they include, you know, a wide spectrum of different sectors, so from the big oil companies to the big food industries. So in a way, your scaling has to, unfortunately, be differentiated a bit between the different communities. And I would say that the food industry part, you know, the Unilevers of this world have come a long way in recognizing that planetary boundary thinking is an integral part of their competitiveness in the future. And of course, that's not surprising because the food industry depends so much on productive agriculture. While it's, of course, much more difficult with the big oil companies or the cement industry or the car industry for that matter. So there's a spectrum there within the World Business Council. But in the leadership of the World Business Council, I would say that, you know, on a scale from 1 to 10, I mean, the commitment from people like Paul Polman, who's the chair of the World Business Council, and Peter Bakker is at the 10 level. I mean, they are adamantly convinced that they need to take this science seriously and transform it into business positioning themselves to be able to navigate this future. But of course, that has, I would say, admittedly, not trickled down throughout the entire network. But the World Business Council is, I think, attracting today more members, for example, by showing that they're serious about this transition. So I think there's, you know, good light in the tunnel there. In fact, so much so that I think that what we're seeing is that leadership in big business often outpaces political leadership today in many countries, no countries named. Okay, I see time is running out. Thanks a lot.
A few quick comments before we adjourn. First of all, I'd like to thank you, Johan, for your excellent lecture this evening. If Canadians and Swedes share anything in common, it's that we both understand deeply the metaphor of the hockey stick. And you spoke very well tonight of the mind shift that's needed, the transformation in our thinking, perhaps a hockey stick in global awareness about the planetary boundaries. We need people who can make a compelling case, who can speak to both expert and scientific audiences, to political audiences, and the broader public. And you've clearly demonstrated tonight your extraordinary powers of communicating both good science and effectively speaking in your commitment to this very important cause. So thank you again for your insights tonight. The video will be posted to our website. You can also add your own comments to a blog that we'll post about this event. And in the coming weeks, we invite you to join us for more public events, including tomorrow, Friday. We're very pleased to have Ontario Premier Kathleen Wynne here to speak about Ontario in the World, Prosperity and Sustainability, really a continuation of tonight's topic. That lecture is sold out here in the auditorium, but we invite you to sign up for the live webcast and watch it online over your lunch. That's at 12:15. And then on Tuesday, March 31st, Professor Jack Goldstone from George Mason University will discuss the impact of growing population on the stability and security of our world as we approach the 10 billion mark. So be sure to register online for our events newsletter and to find out about other upcoming events. Thank you again for coming tonight. Have a safe journey home.